you know.
Cool.
Well, I think we're ready to get going. Terell, thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. I'm going to be recording the session, if you don't mind. So for some of our students who can't make it, we'll have the opportunity to look at this if they're interested. And as Kenny was just saying, in response to the pandemic, we had a pivot because we couldn't rehearse, obviously.
Yeah.
And our organization decided to use some of its available funding, you know, in the generous grants we've gotten from Montgomery County to apply to online lessons, both for the students as well as, you know, help out our local musicians.
Great.
We're in like week 4 or 5 of this. All the kids that were interested are going to get 5 lessons, and many of them have had 3 or 4. We're going to probably do about 90 lessons in this time period. And then that kind of morphed into master classes. And as Kenny was saying, this is our 4th master class. We've had master classes with Sullivan Fortner, Ben Williams. Who am I missing?
Matt Wilson.
Oh, Matt Wilson, the drummer, and now you, Terrell. And we're grateful for the connection. Matt Mason studies piano. In addition to being a percussionist, he studies piano with Paul Bratcher. And we were talking to Paul about the master classes, and we had a little bit room to do one time and some money to do maybe one more class. He recommended that we contact you. So we're very grateful that you responded and that you're able to join us this afternoon. What we have been doing, you know, format-wise, if this works for you, the various instrument instructors have kind of focused on the kids with that instrument, you know, the bassist and the drummers and the piano players. And, you know, heard a little bit of, you know, kind of focused on them, maybe heard a little bit from them and kind of oriented a little bit towards, you know, those particular musicians, you know, as well as just giving us your insights generally into musicianship. You know, these are a great collection of young improvisers who can benefit from knowing how to think about improvisation and how to think about rehearsing properly, particularly during these times when they have plenty of time to do both. So I'm not going to say anything more. I'm going to let you, you know, take it away with our talented young musicians here and have some fun learning together.
Yeah. So it's great to be here. So a few things, you know, this whole pandemic has been an interesting time for me to reflect, and I call it my time of reflection and refinement. Because, you know, as a trumpet player, if this pandemic weren't happening, the fortunate part to it is that I would probably be on the road now and wouldn't be home until close to the end of August. So my book was booked all summer. And then when you're on the road, the hard part is trying to maintain your musicianship, especially for trumpet, trying to maintain just maintenance, of what we do and trying to be consistent as possible. But now that I'm home, I've been, when I say refine, I've been thinking about a whole lot of things that I normally don't get to think about, like refining my routines. I'm a very routine oriented person. So my practice routine, I have 3 routines that I do now. And the first routine is called a maintenance routine. And so just working on my maintenance routine lately, basically what I try to incorporate in my maintenance routine is a way for me to cover the fundamentals of the instrument so that if I were performing now, I could have a consistency in my playing. And now that I'm practicing, I'm using my maintenance routine to feed my second routine, which is my growth routine. And my growth routine has been really expanding since this whole thing. And then my third routine is my exploration routine. So I'll explain the different routines. So for my maintenance routine, I make sure I'm a big fan of breathing. You know, the teacher that I studied my master's with, his name was William Fielder. He was a Arnold Jacobs and Bud Herseth student. And so from him, he really focused on breathing. And when I came to him, after my days as an undergrad in Maryland, my teacher there was really great about working on certain fundamentals. But when I got to Professor Fielder, and actually Wynton Marcellus is the one that told me to study with him. When I got to Professor Fielder, he really started to speak about air and how wind could could really help me out more than it was. So for my own routine, I spend quite a bit of time just breathing exercises. I have a thing called a spirometer. It's an incentive spirometer. If you're interested, I can run and grab it so you can see it. But I use the spirometer. I spend time breathing on that. I spend time buzzing. And then I love these exercises called Chikowitz flow. You may have heard of them. You may have not. I'm addicted to the Chikowitz flow studies. I've developed my own kind of Chikowitz flow study routine. I do some tonguing out of the Arbenz book. I think that for me, my one fear as a trumpet player is fatigue. That's my fear. And so what I do in my practice routine, especially in my maintenance routine, I find ways to build my endurance because I just don't want to get tired. So I lean to the Arbenz book. There's a page in there, 177. I've created an exercise in that Arbenz book. And then my favorite exercise is something called the Goldman study. And I basically play Goldman number one or Goldman number four. And I play this study because I feel like trumpet players, one of the main, the two of the main questions trumpet players like to ask, you know, how can I build my endurance? That's the one question. And then the other question is, how can I play high? Those are the two questions. And both questions, in a way, are both related to air and how we use our air. And that's why I use these things in my maintenance routine. So after I make it through my tonguing, I usually play some flexibility, page 44 in the Arbenz book. And then I finish up with a Charlier etude, either one or two. And then I take a small break. And when I take a break, I think the important thing about my break is that I assess what went well in that first routine and what didn't go well. And sometimes we can just pick up our instruments. And this is what I feel like I was doing before this pandemic. I feel like I was picking up my instrument and playing through my routine and then going to my gig or going to rehearsal and play the rehearsal and then play the performance. And that would be it. But now what I'm doing is after I finish that routine, I have a list of things that I feel that I could improve upon in that first routine. And then I focus on those few things in my next routine, because now it's time that we can really refine what we do. We don't have to rush through anything. There's no rush, you know. So so now I take the time to refine. You know, when I had my lessons with Wynton Marcellus, I took a piccolo trumpet lesson with him because that's what I got my master's degree in classical music, and I really wanted to focus. It was on the evolution of the piccolo trumpet. And when I took a lesson with him, he told me that I needed to work on my attacks. And so I asked him what he did to work on his attacks. And he went into a corner of his apartment and he played an attack over and over and over and over and over. So that's a way that you can really work on, you know, refinement. That's what I mean. So go in a corner and just play a D or an F at the top of the staff until you don't miss it, until you don't chip it. And that's what I've been doing. Just things that I really have always wanted to do. Like in the Charlier etude, it starts dee da 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 da. It's really easy to miss that first note. So how do we avoid missing it? By playing it over and over and remembering the sensation of what it feels like. So I've made it through my maintenance. I get to my growth routine and I work on just refining things that didn't go well. And that could take an hour, could take 2 hours. And then after that, I get to my exploration. And basically my exploration has been making a list of tunes that I don't play very often or I've always wanted to learn. That could be me just sitting down at the piano, just playing through a progression that has always tripped me up. You know, it could be a bridge of a tune. It could be anything that I haven't had the time to spend with. And if over here on my stand, I just, you know, print out music and I just play through tunes just to keep my mind stimulated and look for different options in how I can play. I also have been trying to find and expand my list of transcribing, because I think transcribing is important, not just learning the solo and putting it away, but learning the solo, figuring out what the soloist is trying to say. The word that I use is the intent, trying to figure out the intent of the soloist. What was the message of the solo? You know, if you listen to Louis Armstrong play, he plays this beautiful song called Flee as a Bird from a Mountain. And if we want to hear that later, I can pull that up. But Flee as a Bird from a Mountain, basically it is a New Orleans funeral procession song. And in this song, Louis Armstrong plays the most beautiful, controlled vibrato I think I've ever heard. And just the expression in this piece is, to me, overwhelming. I mean, I think that's the reason why I want to play music, is to express myself. And when Louis Armstrong, he plays a really, really great intro, but just the way he plays this dirge is just really mind-boggling to me. So I've been really, really listening to that and the effectiveness of that. And just, you know, if we listen to Western blues or cornet chop suey, or we listen, you know, to Roy Eldridge play Body and Soul, any of those pieces, now I'm really going back and listening to those pieces and trying to figure out, you know, what is it about this piece? What is it about the solo that really influences me? And that's been my fuel. And I've had the time to do that for the most part, to sit down, to listen to Blue Mitchell play I'll Close Your Eyes over and over and over again until I get sick of it, or sit down and listen to Freddie Hubbard play You're My Everything, and really get inside of what Herbie Hancock, how Herbie Hancock accompanied Freddie Hubbard on You're My Everything, is the most brilliant comping I think I've ever heard. So I've been studying not only just trumpet stuff, but, you know, what piano players, how piano players feed horn players, how can horn players feed piano players or feed rhythm sections. So that's some of the things I've been doing as of late. And I can play, I want to see if I can find this example of Flee as a Bird from a Mountain so that you can hear what I'm talking about. Give me 1 second. Here it is.
A good song.
So you know, when I practice this song, my goal is to make this vibrato. How do we play vibrato? That's what I have time to think about. How did he go?
Yeah,
really studying the art of vibrato. How do we play vibrato? How do we practice vibrato? How do we work on vibrato? How did Louis Armstrong play vibrato? What I mean by that is, what techniques did he use? Did he use a technique that like we use when we play flexibility, our tongue? Did he use his jaw? What did the vibrato that he played in 1926 or 1928, how does that affect us now? So the way it affects us now is that his vibrato that he played then is turned into this. That's the big thing. So when you think about history of Louis Armstrong, why did the vibrato change? Basically, because his vibrato was very much like his singing. It was wide. If you play a wide vibrato on the trumpet, what happens? It breaks the partial. It turns into this really vocal, guttural kind of sound. So I've been studying that kind of sound. I've been working on, has everybody heard "You're My Everything" before? No? So I want to pull up "You're My Everything" and I'm going to show you something that is it okay to play these examples for everyone?
Yeah, of course.
Sure.
I just want to show you what I've been checking out. So I'm going to pull this up. Give me 2 seconds.
Sorry, I nodded. I said, yeah, sorry. Yes, I heard. Sorry.
Okay.
Pretty hard.
Just to talk a little bit. So the thing that gets me about that solo, even before the solo, you know, as a trumpet player, the thing that affects me the most is playing with the rhythm section. Because I remember maybe 20 years ago, I was in Portugal with Ray Brown, and I was traveling. We were playing some concerts, you know, through Portugal. And after one of the concerts, we were all at a dinner table and we were all, you know, speaking to each other about music. And so I asked the amateur, you know, rookie question to Ray Brown. I said, Mr. Brown, like, you know, you being who you are, who have been some of your favorite musicians to play with? And Ray Brown said to me, he goes, you know, there's only two types of musicians, Terrell. He goes, there's the selfish type, the ones that talk about me, and the ones that after they finish playing, they're like, oh, I suck. Oh, I could do better. Oh, me. And he goes, and there's the selfless, the ones that are always wanting to give and always, and you know, as we know, when we give, we receive. So he told me that night, he goes, make yourself a selfless musician. And when I would listen to this recording, that's what this recording reminds me of. The selflessness of Herbie Hancock from the first note of the melody, to me, is what it's all about. And then, you know, we talk about, as improvisers, we use this word that I think is abused, and it's the word that's abused to me is called interaction. We all talk about interaction. We all want interaction. You know, what is interaction? You know, if you think about your best friend, when you want to go speak to your best friend about music, how do you communicate with your best friend about music? Usually what happens is you'll say, hey, man, I love that Freddie Hubbard solo on You're My Everything. And your friend may say, I love it too, but I really love Herbie Hancock. Really, what do you love about Herbie Hancock? That's interaction. That's a conversation. That's how we interact. We interact through listening. And then when we listen, then we respond to what we hear. That's interaction. So when a soloist says, you know, I want to get the rhythm section to interact with me more, that means the soloist has to give the rhythm section something that it can react to or interact with. So the thing I love about this solo with Freddie Hubbard is that Herbie Hancock came with a plan to accompany. That's a beautiful thing. That's what I love. He came with a selfless plan to accompany. And then Freddie Hubbard, all he had to do for the rhythm section to respond to what he played was to leave space. When he left space, the rhythm section could set him up for his next entrance. That's what I believe is genius. I want to play the rest of this because I love James Spalding solo. I love it because James Spalding is super, super, super melodic in a way. Kind of contradictory to Freddie in a weird way. But I really want, especially for the piano players, if you haven't heard this, you got to hear Herbie solo on this. So I'll continue where I left off. Thank you. But there's another thing that's really fascinating to me about this recording as well. So I had the opportunity to meet Freddie, and we had a pretty good relationship. I would call him, and first thing he would say to me is, "Hey, Stafford, are you warming up every day?" And I said, "Yes, Mr. Hubbard, I'm warming up every day." He goes, "Stafford, are you paying your taxes?" I said, "Mr. Hubbard, I'm paying my taxes." And then we go off and start to talk about different things. But people always told me, "Don't ask Freddie questions. Don't ask Freddie questions. Don't ask Freddie questions." But I was fascinated. I wanted to ask him questions. I asked him, I said, "You know, how do you get such a beautiful sound on your recordings? What's the secret to getting a beautiful sound on your recording?" And he says, "You know what you should do? Next time you record, I want you to grab that little knob for your headphones and turn it up. And then when you get in the mic, you're going to play a note. And if it's too loud, it's going to kill your ears. So you start to play to a volume that's softer than what you would normally play. And then you get this round, robust feeling in your recording." And so to this day, that's how I record. I turn my headphones up a little bit. I back off a little bit. I play into the mic and you get a rounder sound. Because for live recording, it's different. But for the record, and so I asked him about the way that he played his time, because when I hear him play time, like on this recording, there's a trust factor. He doesn't play right with the drummer. He's not playing right with the bass player. He's playing just a little bit behind him. And if you hear the record called Doing All Right, it's a Dexter Gordon record. It's a record that Freddie Hubbard was on in his younger days. And he told me that when he did that record, Dexter would yell at him and tell him to stop playing so much, because he was just playing way too many notes. So when you listen to the time of that solo, that's on Hubtones, by the way, that You're My Everything. That's why I showed the picture of it. Go check it out. Go check out the whole recording and check out the drummer's time and where the bass and the drummer's cymbal, how they connect. Because if you study how the drums and the bass play, then you can find a pocket and learn how to manipulate a pocket. Because if you can manipulate a pocket, that's how you affect people emotionally. Okay, so I listen to that, listen to how that interaction is between the two, and then listen to how Freddie does it, or listen to how Kenny does it, or listen to how, Nicholas does it. And then you learn from that. And so these, when I say I have my exploration time that I've been trying to really refine what I do, this is what I do. I'll go listen to this recording over and over. What haven't I heard yet in this recording? What do I need to learn from this recording? Do you guys see what I mean? So, I've talked a lot. So why don't you ask me some questions? I can keep talking. I love to talk, but I want to know what you want to know and what I can help you with.
Well, I think this question, this thing I'm going to say, it's not exactly a question, but I would say, like, not just trumpet players should do that. Like every musician, no matter what instrument you play, should have like your own routine and your own like madness routine or your own growth routine and stuff.
Yep, I think that's a good point. I think what if everybody sat down, and this is what I did when I was younger. I do this even now with my life, because the one thing that I'm afraid of in my life is this word called complacency. You know, I don't want to get to a point in my life, in my playing, that I think that I can play. I don't want to become complacent, because complacent is closely related with ego. And that's a word that I despise. So I would encourage everyone to sit down and write down your goals. You know, what do you want to do 10 years from now? What do you want to do 5 years from now? What do you want to do tomorrow? You know, write down your goals. And then after you write down your goals, write down the things that you love about your playing, and write down the things that you want to improve about your playing. And then the things that you want to improve, that's how you start developing your routine. The things that you love about your playing is what you do in your maintenance to maintain what you love. So we all have to identify, like, what are some things about our playing that we love? For me, I may love sound, or my sound on certain things, or I may, love my articulation when it comes to articulation patterns when I improvise. I'm just giving examples. I'm not saying that I love those things, but so if I do love those things, what am I going to do to work on my sound? Because I love my sound. So what do I do to work on that? What do I do to work on my articulation? And then those things that you write on that list, those things that you feel like you could improve, that's your growth routine. That's like, okay, let me go work on this minor 2-5 through the keys. Let me go play Bird's Blues through the keys. Let me go play Cherokee through the keys. Let me go play Moments Notice through the keys. Let me flush out these things that expose my weakness, you know, and let me work on them. And that's really how we develop these routines, if you wanted to know how to develop the routines. And then your exploration routine, when I drive down the road and I hear a song, I download it instantly. Or if I don't download it, I write it down, you know, so that I can go home and find the recording, whether it's on YouTube or buy it off of Apple Music, because I want to make sure I support my fellow musicians. And I do that. I buy this music, and then I have a list of on my phone things that I want to check out. So that's what I would encourage everyone to do as well.
What age did you know you like wanted to be a musician when you grew up? Like, were you fully committed to music?
You know, so I have this weird disease called dyslexia. I'm dyslexic. So when I was in school, when I was younger, because of my disease, I didn't read at a great level. I wasn't like the greatest student. I was always pretty good at math. And then I was at my grandparents one summer, and I went in my grandparents' closet, bless you, and I saw a trumpet in their closet. And I opened this trumpet, and I became fascinated with this trumpet, because I said, how do people get a sound with only three vowels? So from that minute is when I knew I kind of wanted to play the trumpet. And then as soon as was able to touch the trumpet, I found something that made me feel great. And that was when I was about 13. I said, man, if I could play this trumpet for the rest of my life and make me feel great and make others feel great, that's what I wanted to do. And then when I go to read, you know, because of my eyes, it would frustrate me. But my parents would say, if you want to get to your trumpet and practice, make sure you get your homework done. So my trumpet is the thing that led me in a way through my life. It made me find joy in what I do. So I knew I wanted to do something with music at 13. But then when I got to high school is when I started to do a lot of gigs, you know, a lot of church gigs, a lot of classical things. And that's when I really wanted to do something. I remember when I was in high school, my parents said to me, you know, if you want to go to college, we can't afford for you to go to college. So what you're going to have to do is get a full scholarship. It's the only way you're going to go to college. So I remember I called three people. I called a guy by the name of Fred Irby. I called a guy by the name of Emerson Head. And I called a guy by the name of Bob Isle. And Bob Isle was principal, I think, in the Navy band. Emerson was trumpet teacher at University of Maryland. And Fred Irby was, I think, the principal at Kennedy Center Opera House. So I told those guys, I said, I'm coming to you for you to prepare me to get a full scholarship. Whatever you tell me to do, I will do. And so I would go to each of their houses. I'd get a lesson. They'd write a list of things they wanted me to learn. I'd go and learn it. And then when I got to college, it was sealed, signed, and delivered that I wanted to play trumpet forever. The thing that I didn't know is that after my college, I quit playing trumpet because my teacher really wanted me to play in the center, and I don't play in the center. I play off to the side a little bit. So when I tried to play in the center, nothing would vibrate. And he said, you know, Terrell, I'm worried because if you don't play in the center, you may not be able to play the trumpet past the age of 25. So when he said that, I became super discouraged, and I quit the trumpet. And I became a computer programmer at an insurance company. And during that period is when everything changed, because I didn't practice the trumpet. I didn't play it. And some friends of mine took me to go hear Wynton Marsalis. He was playing at the Kennedy Center with the Eastman Wind Ensemble. And I walked into this concert super discouraged, you know, not really wanting to be there. And Wynton Marsalis didn't come out first. So I was like, oh man, I came to hear Wynton, he's not even playing. But the principal of that wind ensemble, her name is Yvonne Tall. And I thank her to this day, you know, because when I heard Yvonne play the first four or five notes in this concert, it was the most beautiful trumpet I'd ever heard in my life. And I really wanted to go and say something to her that minute. So I finished listening to hear that concert. Wynton came out, he killed it. And so after this concert, I was trying to get backstage to tell Yvonne Tall that she was my hero and thank you, because she inspired me. I really wanted to play again. But I couldn't reach her, and I waited in line and met Wynton Marsalis. And he was the one that says, you know, if you love this trumpet, here's the number of William Fielder. I will treat you to your first lesson if you're serious. And he treated me to that lesson. And after that point, you know, Professor Fielder was a very humbling teacher, and he guided me through my whole career. I lost him. You know, he passed away, you know, maybe six, seven, 8 years ago. But every single thing that has happened to me in my life, I owe it a lot to Professor Fielder. And he's the one that made me performing as a professional musician possible. I know that was a long-winded answer, but I wanted to give you your money's worth.
I have a couple questions. Sure. So those guys you were talking about, Bob Al, Fred Hervey and Emerson.
Yeah.
When you get those lessons from them, like all of them play trumpet and all of them like taught you new things to do in trumpet, or they play like different instruments and they teach you like some things that you can apply into your instrument?
That's a great question. Yeah. So they all play trumpet, but when I read about them, they all had something different to offer. Like Emerson Head was a technician. He was great. He was a great cornet soloist. So his articulation, his double tonguing was faster than I'd ever heard anyone. And he was always super clean, didn't have the biggest sound, but he was always super clean. And Fred Hervey, I just really loved how lyrical he played and his phrasing. I just loved the way he sounded, and his phrasing attracted me. And Bob Isle was just like a super, super, I mean, Fred Hervey was too, but he was super, super consistent. And he just had a way of just teaching fundamentals. So I got my fundamentals from Mr. Hervey from Mr. Isle. Plus Mr. Isle would work on excerpts with me a lot, you know, on C trumpet. Mr. Hervey could have too, but we worked on lyrical things like the Charlier and Conconi and things like that. And then worked on things like my multiple tonguing or my flexibility through the horn vertically, so it was all three contributed to me learning the trumpet.
Since your disease doesn't permit you like to read greatly, you learn all music by ear then?
No, I could. So with dyslexia, I turn words around and so it makes words tricky for me sometimes. So it takes me just a little bit longer to read a book or to read an email, but I get through it. But the thing that's really helped me with music, music for the most part is okay. And with the doctors, you know, years ago, they said, you know, whatever you want to do, you can do it well. You just have to do it all the time. So reading music is something that I love to do. I didn't always love to do it. But when I was offered the Vanguard Jazz Orchestra, I was offered to join. I subbed in the band for like at least 7 years, 8 years before they offered the gig to me. So I've been playing that music for about 17, 18 years now. And it's amazing, you know, going in every Monday night, having to sight read is, you know, that's the only way that you become better at it, you know. You know, Kenny Rittenhouse is an incredible sight reader to play in the band that he plays in. You know, you can't not read and play on a really high level, because every musician in that band plays at the highest level. So, you know, when you, for this disease, it can affect me, but I don't let it, because I make sure I pick up and I read a book so that my eyes can grasp those words, and I make sure that I read music. That's not a problem because of the gigs. However, I'm not reading so much music right now. I'm listening more to Freddie Hubbard and Louis Armstrong right now. But questions?
I have a question. So what do you think is the best path to like improving improvisation other than like listening?
So I have a question for you.
Okay.
What is the best way to learn vocabulary without listening to other people?
Memorizing?
Memorizing what?
The vocabulary.
But you have to listen to someone to memorize it, right?
Yeah.
So there's no way around learning improvisation without listening. Now, there is a way, you know, for me, when I wanted to learn improvisation, I didn't want to listen because I felt like I could open up a book of patterns, or I can open up a book and just learn the patterns out of the book and be a great improviser. It's not the case. Only real way to improvise is to make sure, is A, to find something that you love. That's the part that's tricky. Finding something that you love and wanting to learn something that you love. Now, the tricky part is the things that we love are things like, you know, what you just heard, maybe "You're My Everything" or something else. So what I recommend, you can find books. Like, there's a book by Mark Levine called Jazz Theory. You know, it's a great jazz theory book. You can look through that book. And the reason I love this book is because it'll say, okay, learn this minor 2-5. But on the minor 2-5, it'll give examples of different people playing that five, so that you can see vocabulary. You can see the scale that you can learn, the arpeggio you can learn. So you can see what to do over certain chords. But then if you, there you go, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great, great book. So book and put on, let me show you this, if I can pull it up on my screen. Give me one second.
Wait, can you repeat the name of the theory book that you said?
Yes, it's Mark Levine, Jazz
Theory. Okay, all right.
So there's something that I did for Wynn Marcellus. I'll share this with you if I can find it. Here we go. So I'll explain what I'm going to show you. So basically, Wynn Marcellus, 2 years ago, a year ago, I taught at this, it's called the Band Director Academy in New York. Basically, it's a lot of band directors that come together, and these band directors come together, and the topic of the session was improvisation. And so what I was asked, one of the courses I was asked to teach was a course on melodic solos. Easy, quote unquote, easy melodic solos. And the reason why I taught this course is that when it comes to improvisation, the hardest thing is to find the right solo to learn. That's what makes it so frustrating. If you try to go and learn Cherokee, you know, and listen to Clifford's solo, that's the most aggravating thing to try to. But if you can find solos that you may love, it makes improvising fun. So check this out. See if this will work. So I put together this list. I don't know if you can see the list. So here's a few solos, for example. You know, now of course you're going to have to listen to these, but some of these solos: Chet Baker, New York; Soft Winds, Autumn Leaves; Tangerine; Ken Storm playing Autumn Leaves, or Where Are You? You can see this list. I'll keep scrolling down. This is my favorite right here, but all these are nice. So, but what you can do is I can send this list. If you took this list, you could start with Kinda Blue and go to maybe So What on Kinda Blue, or Freddie Freeloader is even better. Go to Freddie Freeloader and just do me this question. If you know the tune, that's great. If you don't know the tune, sing the melody and sing all the solos. Don't worry about transcribing. Just sing the melody and all the solos. The next day you wake up, sing the melody and all the solos again. And see if you could sing whatever solo you like the best, try to sing it without the recording. Then go pick up your instrument and learn that solo that you could sing without the recording. And I guarantee you, you will learn more from learning a solo from that record than you will ever learn, and I'm not saying this in a derogatory way, than you will ever learn just from having a jazz theory book, even though that jazz theory book is incredible. So that's what I would suggest. I would suggest if you want this list, I'll send it to you. Go listen to—
Yes, please.
Go listen to everything on this list and don't transcribe anything you don't love. If you don't love it, don't transcribe it. Because the way we grow is through transcribing things we love. Now, the way also that we grow is realizing that there's some things that we don't love, and it's because we don't love them because we're afraid of them. So we don't want fear to get in the way. We want to find a way to keep growing. But I want to give you a start and encourage you to say that to be a great improviser, you have to listen and transcribe. The more you listen, the more you learn what you love. Like, I didn't know I loved Freddie Hubbard until someone gave me Hub Tones. And when they gave me Hub Tones, I was like, oh my gosh, you know, it's just one of my favorite records. Did I answer your question?
Yes, thank you so much.
I have a question.
Yes.
Are there any like trumpet theory books or Lipslers or anything that help you build stamina or range you can recommend?
There's okay, so if you write this down, page 44 in the Arbenz book. It's being recorded. Probably listen to it.
Yeah.
So page 44 in the Arbenz is my favorite exercise to practice. And here's how I suggest you practice them. So the exercise is written.
I'm back.
So page 44, Arbenz book. Mm-hmm. And here's how you practice it. You practice it the way it's written, which is major thirds, right? So here's a major. It goes. Right? So that's a major third. So you practice it on a major third. Mm-hmm. As the exercise is written, and I can pull it up on the screen for you if you want. So you
practice. Please.
Okay, hold on. Okay, here we go. All right. So this is my favorite page right here. So I just played the first exercise for you. So if you look at this exercise, all of these are thirds. Some are minor thirds. Some are major thirds. So I practice exercise page 44 the way it's written all the way through. Just the exercise, just number 22. And then I practice these in intervals of a fourth. So instead of playing this G, one and three, I'll play it open. Mm-hmm. And then I'll play it on an interval of a fifth, which is starting on low C. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll practice those down chromatically. Working on this flexibility will improve your agility and your endurance, because those exercises are really enduring. And then this other exercise I'm going to show you, let me find it. And I can send these to you.
Thank you.
Yep. So here's my favorite. Here's the one I was speaking to you about at the beginning. This is my favorite. Hold on, let me share it. This is my favorite exercise in the world. It's called the Goleman study. But here's what I suggest. I suggest that you lower the articulation. I suggest that you play this exercise legato. And I'm going to tell you why. I think too many trumpet players play exercises like this, and air is not the priority. Articulation takes over air. Air should be the priority. So if you play this exercise legato, you have to connect. And if you connect, then it'll your air will propel the exercise as opposed to your tongue. That's high endurance. So don't play it like this. Because there's no air. It's just my tongue. But play it like this. Okay. And another reason I say practice legato is because when we play jazz, we play lines, we don't play a blues like this. It's crazy, right? We play. Right? So that's legato. That's what we want. So you can take this exercise and really turn it into a great endurance exercise. And then the last thing, if you go to the Clark book, go to Clark number 2. So if you go to Clark number 2, and I use this exercise as a soloist, I think there's a couple range building things you can do. This particular exercise, Clark number 2, goes like this. So I'll take that exercise and I'll play that up a fifth, but I'll play it soft. And I'll keep going up by half step and I'll keep it soft. I'll keep it pianissimo. And I feel my corners start to burn. And when they do, I stop. I don't want my lips to hurt because I don't want to play with pressure. I want my corners to react to the air that I put through the horn, you know? So I use those exercises, and the reason why is because if you're playing, you know, you get your flexibility in the upper register. That way, if you want to play lines and you want to play things that are more agile in the upper register, you're prepared for that. So the whole point of the exercises I gave through are all to prepare. The more you prepare, the more confidence you have. The more confidence you have, the more expressive you can be. The more expressive you can be is how you impact people. You want people to feel your expression. You know, when I was 13, my mom played trumpet. So she said to me, she goes, you know, I don't want you to grow up just being a trumpet player that can play a lot of notes. What I want you to do is identify emotion. So I want you to go listen. And when you hear music that moves you emotionally, whether it's joy, whether it's sadness, whether it's excitement, find those emotions and learn what the players are doing. So you can recreate emotion. Be someone that emotes when you play. So that, you know, so I want to learn this Goldman and I want to learn this Clark and I want to learn my flexibility so I can emote so that you can relate to what I have to say. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I have a question.
Yes.
Really, I've been learning solos that you're like, the Chet Baker tune, but not for me. Like, I've learned that solo. Do you recommend any camps for, like, jazz, like, improv especially?
Do I work in any camps?
No, do you, like, any camps that are, like, it could be, like, a sleepaway camp over the summer for, like, learning jazz?
So there's a few camps. Paul Carr has a great camp. The camp that I teach at is a long way away, but I think it's an incredible camp. It's called... It's not happening this summer, but it's called Port Townsend Centrum Jazz Camp. And here's what's interesting about it. Every year, if you watch essentially Ellington, I don't know if you've ever seen the finals that happen in New York. There's 15 bands that compete every year. Every year, the three top bands are from Seattle, Washington. And the level of their playing is outrageous. So years ago, about 15 years ago, John Clayton hired me to teach at this camp. And the fascinating thing at this camp, if you just go look up Port Townsend or Centrum Jazz, just go look at the faculty. It's astounding. Last year, Marquise Hill and I were the two trumpet teachers. The year before, Sean Jones and I, we did it a couple years together. The year before, Ambrose Akin, Missouri. So the trumpet faculty is just crazy. And it's in the middle of nowhere. And these kids come from Seattle. And I invite all these East Coast kids to come to this camp because I think it's a really good camp. I think also the camp that's in upstate New York, Skidmore, is a really good camp. Litchfield is a really good camp. Stanford Jazz Workshop is a really good. So those that I named are pretty international camps. You know, they're local camps, like, you know, Paul Carr's is really great too. But the other ones, like at Port Townsend, we get a lot of students from Japan, a lot of students from Europe, like really great students. So I, you know, it's just a nice place to be. And plus, how often do you get to Port Townsend, Washington? You know? So, did I answer your question?
Yeah, I was like signed up to go to Paul Carr's camp, but I don't think I'm going to be able to go because I'm not allowed to go anywhere.
Not allowed to go anywhere, but you know what? Here's the thing that I think is brilliant about Paul Carr. You know, I met Paul Carr at a pivotal point in my life. I'm going to be honest, I did not like jazz for a long time. So, and because I didn't like it, I never practiced it. I never wanted to be good at it. And then I met this trumpet player by the name of Bud Herseth. And Mr. Herseth told me, if I wanted to be a good trumpet player, I needed to learn all styles. And his favorite trumpet player, he felt was the world's greatest trumpet player. And that person was Clark Terry. That's who Bud Herseth. Bud Herseth was the principal of Chicago Symphony for like 50 years. So, you know, meeting Clark Terry changed my life. Because it made me want to play jazz. And then when I was in school, Kenny Barron was a piano teacher when I was in graduate school. And so I said to Kenny Barron, I really want to learn how to play jazz. And he says, you know what? You should find a way to get a jam session and play at a jam session because you need to learn tunes and you need to be around people. And I called Paul Carr because I knew him from when I was in college. And I said, Paul, do you know of any jam sessions? And he goes, man, I'm starting a jam session in a month. You want to be on it? And I came down. I was at Rutgers in New Jersey. I came down to Tacoma Station was the name of this club. And I started to play with Paul Carr. And I probably knew like 5 jazz standards. And so you know Paul. Paul heard me play. He goes, man, you got to learn some tunes. You sounded sad tonight. And I said, I'm so sorry, Paul. And he said, man, you got to learn some solos. You got to do this. He would wake me up. He would let me stay at his house, and sometimes I had a 10 o'clock train to catch. Paul would wake me up at like 6 a.m. He goes, man, you don't need to be sleeping. You know what you need to be doing? I said, what? Working on them 2-5s. Do you know how many 2-5s you missed last night on the gig? So he'd wake me up at 6, and he'd say, learn this lick. And I'd be half asleep and go, he goes, now you stay and play through the keys, and then I'll take you to the train station. So he was an incredible mentor to me, and he still is. He's a great guy. So even though you can't go to the camp, you can send him an email and say, "Hey, Paul, I'm transcribing this. What instrument do you play?"
I play trumpet.
So Paul, I'm transcribing this Kenny Dorham solo. Check it out and tell me what you think. I guarantee you'll get an email. Say, Paul, I'm learning this Blue Mitchell solo. Send it to him. Ask for some. I'm sure you'll get it.
Yeah, thank you.
Yep. Other questions?
Are there any days like now, like in this time, that like you never want to pick up your trumpet or you just like don't feel like playing?
No. You know why? Because I have the exact opposite feeling, to tell you the truth. So like my day, since I run the music program at Temple, the instrumental program at Temple, I've been on Zoom since 9 o'clock this morning. I had a half hour break at noon. I got up at 5 this morning so I could practice from 6 to 8, and then get ready for my 9 o'clock Zoom day. So I've gotten a couple hours of practice in. I'm craving to pick up my trumpet, but I've been meeting all day on Zoom. So it's right here to me. And through my meetings, I just look at it like, I'm going to get to you. Don't worry, I'll get to you. And so, you know, I have a 3-year-old. So when I get off this phone call, I'll go play with her. And then when she goes to bed, this is my new best friend.
Yeah.
Yes. I'll put this in and play to my heart's content tonight. So there hasn't been a day that I don't want to play the trumpet. I want to play it more and more and more. Because there's so much to learn, you know. I could take this time. I mean, there's some people that are freaking out because of what's going on. And yes, it's a scary time, but man, we have more than most people do. We have music, and we have community, and we have friends. I look at this screen, and you know, this screen could pop up every day. You guys could be talking and playing and sharing. And that's what I have. Earlier today, I told Tim Warfield, my best friend, we're going to talk tonight, you know, and we just call and just lift each other up. So that's what can happen now. And he may call and say, "Hey man, check this solo out. I've been shedding. He'll play it. So there's not a day that goes by I don't want to pick up my trumpet. There's a day that I wish there was 28 hours in a day so I could have more time to get to it.
You said you didn't originally want to play jazz. What did you play? And why did you decide? I mean, I understand you said that playing different types of music helps your skill, and I totally agree. But what were you playing before?
All classical. So when I started at 13, I started in Chicago, and my parents would take me to hear the Chicago Symphony. I would hear Bud Herseth. And my mom, being a trumpet player, she'd sit next to me, and every time Mr. Herseth would play a note, she'd say, "That's the standard. That's the standard." And so for all my life, my dad grew up with Cannonball Adderley, and he really wanted me to play jazz, but none of my peers were really playing jazz when I started to play. And so I played all classical music. I got my undergraduate degree at University of Maryland, and they didn't have a jazz program when I was there. And so I got my undergraduate degree there. And then I got really discouraged because I played in the jazz band there, but I wasn't really taught improvisation or how to solo or what to do. And then I auditioned for graduate school, and I wanted to audition for the jazz program, but I didn't know jazz. And so I went and auditioned anyway, and I got rejected from the jazz program at Rutgers, but I got accepted into the classical program. So that kind of tainted me, you know, until I went through a year of the program and I met some jazz folks and got exposed to it more. And that's when I started to go a jazz way. So I was about 23 or 24 when I started to play jazz.
I'm a 16-year-old vocalist, and jazz is not generally what she prefers, but when she's exposed, her enthusiasm tends to increase when she meets someone that excites her. Mm-hmm. Interesting thing is, her vocals are all over the place. It's classical, it's jazz, it's opera, R&B. It's all over the place. And she likes it because she says she's exposed to different things. But I'm trying to get her to maybe focus. I'm not quite sure how to encourage her, how to focus. I see that she's encouraged and focused more when there's someone that is able to help her to get a step further.
Yeah, that's a tough one. You know, I mean, you know, there's so many, especially now it would be a great time to reach out to some really great, there's like as soon as you said, you know, mentioned this, the vocalist, I instantly thought about Renee Marie. I don't know if you know her. So Renee Marie is just, she's an incredible human being, first of all. She's one of my favorite vocalists, but she's one of the most real and passionate people I've ever met. And so, you know, someone like Renee could be someone to be a mentor, you know, and to and to not, I didn't play jazz because of insecurity, you know, and you know, because you listen to, you know, the page that I pulled up, the classical page, I was comfortable reading music and I was comfortable playing these exercises. I wasn't comfortable leaving the music. And then when I met people who encouraged me to do so and I trusted them, then I went the route of jazz. So maybe her just connecting with someone who's really good and someone who's really passionate and you know, there could be a relationship that could lead to the focus and to the enthusiasm as well. And this
Yeah, I want to support her in what she wants to do. I think that's what's most important. But I think even now she's listening, she's on another Zoom call because she's doing quite a bit of Broadway stuff. She gets a lot of opportunities for stage acting and, you know, vocals there. So she does a lot of that because that seems to excite her. Yeah. When she started with jazz, I mean, even now she's very excited about it. Kenny connected her with a young lady by the name of Lena. I can't remember Lena's last name, and she really likes her. What's her last name?
Lena Sagley.
Yeah, so she really likes her, and she has been able to learn quite a bit from her. I'm just really wanting to know what I can do best for her. I wanted her on this call, but she had two calls at the same time, so she couldn't be here, but thank you. I enjoyed it.
Terrell, this is Gary Mason.
Likewise.
We've been going over, taking up a little bit more time than we anticipated. You're eager to get back to both your daughter and your trumpet, it sounds like. So we don't want to keep you. But thank you so much for spending this time with us this afternoon. This has been just a great experience. I think the kids learn a lot from hearing from great musicians like you about you know, thinking about being better players and about their careers. And I hope that we'll have the opportunity to see you again when we're performing back in Bethesda.
Yeah.
And maybe in the semesters to come, you'll have the chance to visit with us live and either lead a workshop or participate as a featured artist. And it's just great to have the opportunity to meet you and spend some time with you.
Same here.
So thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Terrell.
Thanks,
Terrell. Thank you so much. It's been great.
Is Terrell a local artist or? Is he located someplace else?
Terrell's in Philadelphia. Or you actually live in New York or you live in Philly?
I live in between. I live near Princeton, New Jersey. I'm an hour from New York because I play there mostly. And I'm an hour from Philly because that's where I teach. So I'm smack dab in the middle.
Okay.
Quick train ride down to D.C. So we look forward to seeing you in the fall when we get past all this.
Sounds great. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
All right, Terrell.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
See you.
See you.